Soviet Russia was considered as the largest country in the world on January 1, 1991, with a total land area of 8,650,000 square miles and the second largest economy of the world according to historical records. There was a Cold War between the USSR and the USA over global power, as it was the biggest rival for the United States in terms of economic, political, and military affairs. However, this great nation collapsed politically as well as economically at the beginning of the last decade of the 20th century due to a combination of internal and external reasons. Through this video, we are going to investigate the reasons behind this great economic collapse. Before we proceed, hit the subscribe button and smash the bell icon for more interesting political and economic news. Rulers of the Soviet Union strongly believed in the central command economic policy than any other successful economic policy in the world. Under its policy, their economy was totally built up on the base concept of state ownership. So all the processes like production, farming, and industrial manufacturing were totally controlled by the government, without allowing any opportunities for private entrepreneurs or businesses within this economic model. Based on these state ownerships, the economic affairs of the country were managed through Gosplan, Gosbank, and Gosnab, which were the State Planning Commission, the State Bank, and the State Commission for Materials and Equipment Supply, respectively. The economy of the Soviet Union economy experienced a rapid economic growth during the early stages of the communist regime. Their underdeveloped economy was adopted for Western technology by the communist rulers, and for that reason, the productivity of the industrial sector of the nation was heavily boosted, finally causing a rapid economic development. With their centralized economic policies, there were economic inefficiencies like lack of open markets providing price signals and incentives to direct economic activity. However, they didn't cause many problems at the early stages. Since 1930, Soviet Russian governments followed a series of five-year plans to improve their economy, and Russians started enjoying the results of these economic policies at the middle part of the 20th century. With the time, the economic base of the Soviet Union changed from an agriculturally based economy to an industrial one when it was 1950. When it was the 1970s, the Soviet economy was much more complex than early stages, and it was difficult for state planning commissions to introduce development models to imitate. So, their economic growth was considerably reduced for that reason, and the average GNP growth rate was decreased up to 3.7% during the period between 1970 and 1975. It was further reduced to 2.6% during the period between 1975 and 1980. Despite the economic development that they experienced in the 1950s, communist rulers knew about the long-term problems and inefficiencies associated with their command economic policy. That's why rulers like Nikita Khrushchev introduced reforms like Sovnarkos as an initial attempt to decentralize economic control, offering the chance to create a second economy to deal with rising complex economic matters. Unfortunately, most of the state institutions which were established to carry out the operations related to the command economy despised those economic policies, and they forced Khrushchev to abandon those economic policies, opening the doors for a pure command economy again. One of the major strengths of the Russian economy was the presence of a heavy supply of oil and gases within its own territories. In the 1970s and 1980s, oil and gas prices skyrocketed, and Russia was able to generate a huge profit through the export of oil and gases. However, oil prices suddenly dropped from a value of $120 to $24 per barrel in 1986, destroying one of the main methods of generating foreign revenues. So, Soviet unions had no sufficient foreign revenues to run its economy in the late 1980s, further aggravating the problem. Even though oil prices spiked again during Iraq's invasion of Kuwait in August 1990, the Soviet economy already passed the recoverable limit at that moment. So, the decline of oil prices in the global market played a huge role in collapsing the Soviet Union. The closest factor that affected their collapse was Mikhail Gorbachev's failed regime, which began in 1985. After appointing him as the General Secretary of the Communist Party of the Soviet Union, his main goals were to jumpstart the moribund Soviet economy and to streamline the cumbersome government bureaucracy. Then he came up with a set of reforms initially, and they failed without causing any positive effect on the Russian economy. But he didn't want to stop by that failure, and introduced policies like glasnost and perestroika, which later caused heavy damage to the Soviet Union politically as well as economically. As a result of the glasnost policy, communist regime lost its authority over media as well as public sphere to control the criticism regarding the communist policies that they used to govern the state. This was a huge boost to the movements which demanded the democratic-type reformations to the country. Perestroika policy created a great openness in their economy, and this was a direct opposition to their command economic policies. However, this policy also failed as Soviet firms started to take the advantage of new freedoms and new opportunities, fading away the initial success of these policies. Perestroika policies led to the lifting of price controls in some markets while keeping the bureaucratic structures in some places that allowed the communist officials to change the policies that did not benefit them personally. As the final output of these long-term economic problems, the great economic contraction was visible in the late 1980s and early 1990s, which was the last stage of the Soviet Union. Even though there was a great economic crisis, communist leaders had no sufficient power to intervene in the problem. So, newly empowered leaders through the new policies demanded greater autonomy from the central authority, destroying the pillars of the commanding economy. On the other hand, Mikhail Gorbachev's reforms and his abandonment of the Brezhnev Doctrine led to the political collapse of the Soviet Empire. Actually, Brezhnev Doctrine was the foreign policy introduced by the Soviet leader Leonid Brezhnev in 1968, providing the political background to intervene in countries where the socialist rule was under threat. As the first sparks of the collapse of the Soviet Union, Hungary removed its border fence with Austria, and Solidarity acquired power in countries like Poland and the Baltic states, taking some solid steps towards independence. At the same time, the Berlin Wall was toppled, unifying East and West Germany, reducing the political authority of the Soviet Union in many parts of Eastern Europe. So, the Soviet Union no longer had sufficient economic power to defend the ongoing political crisis using its military powers. As the final output of the crisis, it fragmented into 15 separate states, destroying the biggest challenge for the United States in majority of the global affairs. In that way, the second largest economy of the world in the 20th century collapsed, mainly due to its own bad economical practices. Communist rulers had enough chances to recover before this economic collapse. If they really wanted to move out of the harmful policies of the command economy, then thinking about their personal gains. If the Soviet Union went ahead with the Sovnarkoz reforms introduced in 1950s, the Communist Party had the best opportunity to save the economy from the decline that it experienced two or three decades later. Even though Gorbachev played the most critical role in the collapse of the Soviet Union, every communist ruler who governed the nation had their own responsibility behind this collapse.